HipHopsIs1987.com.
During that process, during that time?
You know, in a lot of ways, it's easy. It's easy. You know, when you have a roster that has gone through such an adverse situation as we did during that time, it's no longer about me. It has to be about we, because we have to figure out how to get ourselves out of this situation. You know, there's some point in during that streak where it's hard and it's frustrating, and instead of pouting and fighting as a competitor, you're trying to find the best answers that you can. So it was easy for us to coach a group that was willing to work, willing to learn, and willing to rally together to get themselves. They didn't want to, they had pride. They didn't want to extend that streak and be in the record books. And the pride, the competitiveness of our guys, and the rallying together, it's a unique situation. It's hard to say that, but that's truly what happened.
Did you have to turn the TV off, get off Twitter? Because it made so much noise.
And you can't hide. I mean, it's the NBA. You can't hide. And as a competitor, you know, the guys want to talk when things are going well. You can't hide when things aren't going well. And, no, that didn't bother us one bit. One of the things you teach, and I think everybody does, is you gotta keep the noise out. Whether you're winning and you're on cloud nine, you don't want to fill your head and get too ahead of yourselves. And whether you're struggling and people are starting to criticize, you don't want to take offense to it. Control the narrative and do what you can. Attack the day and try and get better each and every day. But you can't worry about the outside sources.
And then going forward, what did you learn from it, and how do you apply that to this day?
You know, the beauty of work ethic. I was just talking about TJ McConnell, who's a guy that embodies everything there is about growth and development. He's an undrafted player that's in his third year that may have had one of the biggest games in a playoff series for an undrafted player in game four in the second round. But that's 3 years of commitment, that's 3 years of hard work, that's 3 years of the development. And one thing I've learned is if you're patient and guys buy into what you're trying to teach, they can see themselves being a TJ McConnell where there's growth and there's opportunity to grow.
Yeah, because, I mean, one of the things that the Hawks had done well was player development. You see a lot of these guys who, Hardaway, some of these guys who have come along.
Right.
How do you kind of keep that going forward with guys like baseball or some of these younger guys?
Yeah, you know, it's going to be a new day here. It's a new voice with me being here. It'll probably be a few newer voices as well as I built the staff out. But anytime there's change, there's excitement. You don't know what the outcome is going to be. You're just looking forward to, you know, how can I get better? And that's the message that I'll have to our players is, you know, how can I help you get better? And, you know, I think as we attack the day and we come into the gym every day, you know, they're going to be eager to see what I bring, and I'll be eager to see how they work. And then as we collaborate, we communicate, we develop these relationships, that's the key. That's the key to any franchise.
And then last thing for me, did you take that virtual tour of the arena? If so,
I haven't.
Okay.
You know, we played there late in the season. We played two games late in the season in April. So you can see the signage and the messaging of what's going on. I haven't seen it while it's been under construction. I'm sure it probably doesn't look very pretty right now. But, you know, to me, it's just more about the commitment. The owners committing to the franchise and wanting to better the arena and the fan experience and the game experience. So regardless of any of those things, I think it's just an exciting opportunity to see what's next and to see what that arena is going to look like once the season begins.
Coach, did you think that this opportunity would come to you so soon, being an assistant coach for so long, being in Philadelphia for the past few seasons? Did you think your opportunity would come this quick?
Well, opportunity is just what it is. It's you know, it's a chance to do more. It's a chance to grow. As an assistant coach, my main and only focus was to assist our head coach and assist the program that I was in. I wasn't looking for the next coaching job. I wasn't looking for the next opportunity on a different team. I was just trying to do my job where I was. When the opportunity presented itself, it was more about just evaluating whether or not the fit was there and if it was the right timing.
Now, you recently come from Philadelphia. I know it's been a championship aura in the city with the Eagles winning the championship. Villanova winning the championship. And then the Sixers almost going to the brink of going to the Eastern Conference Finals. Now here in Atlanta, you know, it will be a rebuilding season. What do you think about the fan base? And do you feel like there's any pressure with the Falcons doing well out here, with the soccer team doing well, Atlanta United? Do you feel like there's any pressure to bring a championship or at least get the team back to the postseason?
No, I don't think it's pressure. I think, you know, as we've talked about this, we're talking about building an organization to where it's a winning culture. And what that means is we have to do what we need to do to develop the current roster. We need to do what we need to do to develop the organization and finding the right people that share that vision. I wouldn't say it's a rebuild. I think it's just more about development and growth. Our vision is the end game. We want to be a championship contending organization. And whatever that takes, we're committed to doing, and I'm committed to helping our players on the court do that.
And my last question for you, sir. I understand the draft is right around the corner. Is there anyone that you secretly have your eye on that you think would be a key piece to bring down here to the Hawks?
I don't. You know, a week ago I was playing game four in the Eastern Conference semifinals, and now I'm going through a press conference as the head coach of the Atlanta Hawks. So I haven't spent much time on the college basketball scene. We will be heading to Chicago this week, and that'll kind of be my introduction to this current class.
Thank you, Coach. Philly for 5 years.
Yeah.
When it's a long process like that, how do you prepare your team for what the league might be in a few years when it evolves over time versus what it is when you start?
No, that's the beauty of the job, and it's the beauty of coaching. You know, how do you prepare for what's coming? A lot of our league now is centered on the three-point line and three-point shooting, and you see teams that got the jump early, Golden State, Houston, have taken and included analytics and valued the possession, valued the shot, and one of the things that, you know, can your five men shoot threes, and how many can they shoot? Can you avoid shooting mid-range shots? And, you know, how do you get to the foul line and get to the rim? You know, we'll continue to do that here, using analytics, using a staff that can study the game and try and best position our players. So we're playing high efficient basketball on the offensive end and trying to force teams to play low efficient basketball on the defensive end. But that's the challenge. You want to find players that can adapt and adjust to where the game is headed. And you want to have a staff that studies and creates an advantage analytically and strategically that fits where the future of the game is going.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Hip-hop's is 1987.com.